So yes, history of the love song. So before we get into some of the detail, what is a love song? Well, of course, it's a difficult term to be definitive about, but there are many, many songs about love, first of all, or which refer to love. For example, the editors of the Penguin Book of Folk Song estimate that 50% of folk songs were or are concerning love. That's true of all forms of popular music, really, right through to the dance music and the rap of today, also in roots music, the blues, country music. One finds many songs about love, particularly the trials and tribulations of love. But a love song is something different. So I want to make a distinction now between songs that are about love that mention love, or between that and a love song as such. That's a different thing altogether. Because a love song is a direct communication between someone and the object of their love, or an expression via a third party, via somebody else, about that love. That is what a love song is. So there's got to draw that distinction. Otherwise, practically every song ever written would be classified as a love song, and they're everywhere. About one third of the current top 40 consists of out and out love songs. So the question then arises, why? Why are they so prevalent? Well, it's because that music, this kind of music, popular music, is predominantly made by the young, and it's the main subject on the minds of young people. But also at a deeper level, we don't always talk about things, about our feelings, and particularly men who have traditionally written the most songs. So this is another way of expressing feelings. It's an insight into what otherwise might be a hidden or a secret world, things we don't like to say, things we can't say, but we can sing them in a song. Also, a sense that the history of the love song is very clearly almost the history of song itself, almost the history of music itself, almost, but not quite. Well, love songs have been around for centuries. There's evidence that something approximating to a love song existed in ancient Egypt. And examples, or tentative examples, putative examples, can be found online and on YouTube of that. Certainly, as far as ancient Greece is concerned, music, love songs perhaps, were accompanying weddings in Greece. And we know too that in Greek religion, Erato was the patron of lyric and erotic poems or songs. And this painting on the right is a modern representation of her. But from what we know, it seems that love songs were not as common in the ancient world as they are now. The oldest known love song is the Song of Shu Sin, and we're going to hear something about it now.
In Mesopotamia, we find the world's oldest love poem written by hand that has survived, dating to around 2000 BCE and uncovered in the library of the Assyrian king Ashurbanipal. The love song of Shu Sin is both a love poem and part of a sacred ritual. This Sumerian ritual was called the sacred marriage, where the king would symbolically marry the goddess of love and procreation, Inanna, and mate with her to ensure fertility and prosperity for the coming year. The poem, concerned with both romantic and erotic love, was read by the bride for the ritual, but other aspects of the sacred marriage are unknown. But the stories on some of these tablets were found to be earlier versions of well-known biblical narratives, such as the Great Flood. The same is true of the love song of Shu Sin, which wasn't translated until 1951. Prior to this, the Song of Solomon from the Bible was considered the oldest love poem in the world. The love song of Shu Sin, in translation by Samuel Noah Kramer, goes like this: Bridegroom, dear to my heart, goodly is your beauty, honey sweet. Lion, dear to my heart, goodly is your beauty, honey sweet. You have captivated me. Let me stand tremblingly before you. Bridegroom, I would be taken by you to the bedchamber. You have captivated me. Let me stand tremblingly before you. Lion, I would be taken by you to the bedchamber. Bridegroom, let me caress you. My precious caress is more savory than honey. In the bedchamber, honey-filled, let me enjoy your goodly beauty. The history of festivals and rituals concerning romantic love clearly dates back to ancient Mesopotamia.
Well, music was important to the Romans too, mainly as an accompaniment to social occasions and ceremonies. And in the 9th century, a musical notation was developed in the Byzantine Empire. In the post-Roman period, that's from the 5th century onwards, the two main uses for music were, first of all, religious music, as an accompaniment, often with a stringed instrument, to the recitations of legends. But neither of those areas was particularly suitable or conducive to love songs. They developed rather later, in the late 11th century, when we had lyric poems, fundamental to something called courtly love. Courtly love developed in what is now France, Aquitaine, Provence, Champagne and Burgundy, where knights performed chivalric tasks to impress the women of the court. And these deeds found expressions in the lyric poetry written by troubadours or by minstrels. And minstrels we may think of as coming from the lower echelon of society, but not so. A lot of them came from the nobility. People like William the 10th, Duke of Aquitaine. He lived from 1071 to 1126. I think, in fact, he was the father of Eleanor of Aquitaine, who later married King Henry II of England. So they were all high-born as well as low-born. In any case, most marriages in those days were arranged for dynastic reasons rather than for love. And so the medium of the lyric ballad became really important as coded messages of love between, within a marriage it could be, but more commonly outside marriage. Indeed, William himself was excommunicated for adultery. So a lot of these ballads became important parts of Western European music. This is a piece of music, a love song by the French composer Guillaume de Machaut, who lived from about 1300 to 1377. One of his songs was called Douce Dame Jolie, Sweet Pretty Lady, which go, sweet pretty lady, for God's sake, do not think that anyone rules over me but you alone. For endlessly and without falsehood, I've cherished you, and humbly all the days of my life, I've served you, with no unworthy thought. Alas, and I beg for hope and aid, for my joy is ended, if you do not take pity. So this is the group La Mora now, performing that song, Douce Dame Jolie. So now we're entering the period of the Renaissance. This period in music history is when the major composers were largely writing for religious reasons, for religious music. And the clients included kings, queens, dukes, and popes. And so this was a different kind of area altogether. As the slide says, polyphonic music was in fashion then. That is music with several voices operating at the same time. So you get these very complex layers. So an era dominated by religious music, one composer of the late Renaissance broke the mold, and his name was John Dowland. As you can see from the slide, he lived from about 1562 to 1626. And the way that he broke the mold was that he wrote mainly secular music. Plus, he came at music from a different angle, not from church music, as I say, not from the organ, which was the fundamental instrument for his predecessors, but from the lute. He was a lute soloist. He wrote over 88 songs for lute accompaniment. And in fact, he was a kind of very early version, what today we call a singer-songwriter, a rock star, really, of his day.
Can she excuse my wrongs with virtue's cloak? Shall I call her good when she proves unkind? Are those clear fires which vanish into smoke? Must I praise the leaves where no fruit I find?
Well, Renaissance music gave way to the Baroque period around about the year 1600, because that brought with it a new musical form, the opera. First operas appeared at the end of the 16th century. The very first one was Daphne by Jacopo Peri, first performed on the 26th of December, 1598. But thanks to composers like Claudio Monteverdi, the opera flourished during the 17th century. It spread all around Europe, and particularly initially to France. Now, arias initially were of two types: binary, that's where you had one melody and a second melody, or they called da capo arias, where you had one melody, a second melody, and then back to the first melody, but more embellished. That's a da capo aria. Now, although the opera was invented in Italy, even when it spread to other countries, Italian was used for the libretto, the words, and other traditions hung on as well. A tradition having the male lead with a high-pitched voice. Now, initially, this was the castrato, who, as the term implies, castrated young men who appeared in operas, initially as women, because the Pope banned women from stage performances. But eventually, and it's a strange process that took place, these castrati became the male lead in many operas. And that's what we're going to see in action in the next opera. Not a castrato, I should point out, but a modern equivalent with a falsetto voice. This comes from an opera by Handel. Xerxes comes from 1738, we're in now. The libretto was written by Count Niccolo Minato, amazing librettist who pretty much covered about 60 years worth of opera from about 1650 onwards. By then, Handel's work was becoming a bit more satirical, and this was supposed to be satirical. This was, on the face of it, a ridiculous spectacle of a king singing to a plane tree, from which his lover emerges. The only problem is, the melody was so heart-rending and so beautiful that it became a freestanding aria, often performed on its own now, and one of the most famous arias of all time, really. So I want to see Andreas Scholl now performing this beautiful aria, Ombra Mai Fu.
Thank you.
some composers became specialists really in arias. One of the greatest was this man pictured on the right, Giacomo Puccini. He lived from 1858 to 1924. Well, among his well-known arias are Un bel di vedremo, One Fine Day We'll See, from Madame Butterfly, and Nessun Dorma, Let Nobody Sleep, from the opera Turandot. I'm going to show you an aria by Puccini on this occasion, working with the librettist Giovacchino Forzano from one of his lesser known operas called Gianni Schicchi. And this aria is called O Mio Babbino Caro, O My Dear Papa. So this is O Mio Babbino Caro, sung by the late Montserrat Caballé. Well, not long after that aria, and indeed that opera, was first heard, and in the same city, New York, came the dawn of the golden age of American songwriting. At first, these songs were for Broadway shows, the direct descendant of the English-influenced musical comedies that proliferated in New York at the turn of the 20th century. It might surprise some people to know that around about 1900, what was in fashion in New York were English musical comedies. But thanks to the efforts in particular, Jerome Kern up there on the top left there, and next to him, Irving Berlin, thanks to those two largely, American songwriters now began to get a grip on these shows that they never, ever relinquished. But with 1927's Showboat, with music by Jerome Kern, lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein, the song and the plot started to become linked, in fact, integrated. And from then on, the integrated musical was born. So really, we can date the beginning of the modern musical to 1927, to that show. Well, alongside Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin were people like Cole Porter, there he is there, and the team up on the right-hand side there, Richard Rogers and Lorenz Hart, and down here, George and Ira Gershwin, many, many others. Sometimes known, this group of writers, as the poets of Tin Pan Alley, the poets, because they, in some sense, were poets. They used many of the techniques common in traditional poetry. Now, and the Tin Pan Alley bit comes from where the song publishers were located in New York. The reason it Tin Pan was that it's a reference to the sound of pianos banging away from this building all at once. It sounded like someone banging a tin pan, many tin pans. Now, these writers really did experiment with the love song and different ways of doing it. So you had the comic love song, for example, a song like Cole Porter's Let's Do It. Birds do it, bees do it, even educated fleas do it, leading to your expectation that this song is going to be about a physical kind of love, but in fact you get Let's Fall in Love. very rhythmic type of songs like Irving Berlin's What'll I Do, very staccato melody matching the mood of the singer, the singer's enervated state of mind. What'll I do when you are so far away and I am blue? What'll I do? Almost bang out the rhythm to that. Whimsical songs like George and Ira Gershwin's The Man I Love, a song for somebody who doesn't even exist, someone who only exists in the singer's imagination. And there were also the poetic love songs. An example I'm going to play is Rodgers and Hart's My Funny Valentine, written in 1937 for a show long since forgotten called Babes in Arms. And here we've got the striking use of an original use of rhyme, laughable with unphotographable, hair for me, care for me. But also the whole idea is a kind of poetic idea of turning an apparent insult into a compliment. And many, many versions of My Funny Valentine that I could have chosen. I've chosen this one by Chet Baker, though, and it's got the lyrics up so you can go through it.
My funny Valentine, sweet comic Valentine, you make me smile with my heart. Your looks are laughable, unphotographable, yet you're my favorite work of art. Is your figure less than Greek? Is your mouth a little weak? When you open it to speak, are you smart? But don't change your hair for me. If you care for me, stay, little Valentine, stay. Each day is Valentine's Day.
Well, the compositions of these poets of Tin Pan Alley that I've mentioned became eventually known as standards. And following the invention of the LP in 1948, singers recorded whole collections of them on one record. But now we're into the 50s, and that was not the cutting edge music anymore. The cutting edge music of the 50s was rock and roll. And in rock and roll, love songs were supplanted by songs about love, the other category that I was mentioning. Not the same thing, because rock and roll songs were encased in that hard driving, consciously unsentimental setting, deliberately designed to overturn musical traditions, not to follow them. Many rock and roll songs were written by the artist themselves, or more commonly, they were derived from African American blues and rhythm and blues traditions, where love songs on the Tin Pan Alley model were virtually non-existent. Eventually, though, the professional songwriters got a hold of rock and roll, and by replacing the leading lights of the pre-war period, there was a new generation of professional songwriters, many of whom were based in the building you see on the right-hand side at 1619 Broadway, constructed in 1931. You can see it in the design of it, the Art Deco production. And almost as soon as it was built, it became a hub for the popular music industry, publishers, writers, management companies. Other people were based in nearby locations, notably 1650 Broadway. But this was the most important centre. In fact, the Brill Building became a generic term for all of these locations that were in the locality. And in 1962, the Brill Building contained 165 music businesses, so overcrowded that writers had to work out their songs in corridors and in cubbyholes. And these writers were later some household names, people like Neil Sedaka, Neil Diamond, but most of all, the lyricist Jerry Goffin and his wife, the composer Carole King. Now, 10 years later, Carole King became a major star in the singer-songwriter idiom, a time when at last female singer-songwriters like Joni Mitchell were starting to come to the fore. And in fact, Carole King did record this song we're about to hear now, one of her songs written by Jerry Goffin, a man. It's interesting. When you hear the song, you'll find that remarkable, I think. She put it on her 1971 album Tapestry, but it was first recorded 3 years earlier by Aretha Franklin. And this is it, A Natural Woman, it's called. Well, I have to say that since around that time, 1968, there really hasn't been a great deal of progress in a love song, because pop has been dominated by styles unaccommodating to the love song: punk, disco, hip hop, indie, electronic music of all types and so on. Not really the home for love songs. There have been some good love songs, but in essence, they're no different now than they were back when they were 50 years ago. So I'm going to close this presentation with a love song from 1969, a song described by Frank Sinatra, and he should know, he sang many of them, as the best love song of the 20th century. It's a song called Something by the Beatles, written by George Harrison. Now, those of you who may have watched Peter Jackson's recent film, Get Back, you'll remember the almost casual way that this song was put together. George Harrison asked John Lennon's help with the line that eventually became "Attracts me like no other lover." But he just can't get this line at all, and go ask John Lennon what to do about it. John Lennon says, just say whatever comes into your head each time. Attracts me like a cauliflower, for example, until you get the words that you want. In other words, don't let a thing like that stop you. It's good advice. What's astounding to me is that George Harrison, had he never met John Lennon and Paul McCartney, may never have written a song at all, let alone one given this great accolade by Frank Sinatra. I just want to do a little bit of analysis about it, because one thing we haven't really done is kind of strip down why these songs are so effective. And this, in this case, it's a song containing what's known as descending chromatic notes. So they are C, B, B flat in this case. Oh, sorry, the C, C major, 7, C7 and F, containing the chromatic notes C, B and B flat. What chromatic notes are basically are notes that don't fit, were not part of the original key. And what you get then is this this descent, and then descent is repeated. So the descent, the chromatic notes already are quite striking. But then you get the descent, and then the descent again. So what's happening in the song is you're getting this up and down motion of, in the song, which reflects the uncertainty that runs through the song, at times down, at times up. You're asking me, will my love grow? Well, I don't know. It's a kind of uncertain song that he's written here. Also, there's some unexpected chord changes. I mentioned the impact of key changes earlier on. Chord changes can really play with the emotions too. So, and sometimes they don't have a positive effect too, given the moments of positivity, the chord change just before, you know, I believe in how. So that's part of the effect that is behind this song.
Anybody got any comments to make? You need to unmute yourself if you have.
No, I think it was superb, that. Brilliant hours entertainment.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think the interesting thing about it is that as I say, there are lots of love songs around the moment, but the format hasn't progressed. So, you know, may be sitting there saying, when's he going to get on to 2023 and what's happening now? But really, if you listen to love songs, they're not really, they haven't progressed at the same speed, let's say, developed in any real way. So thanks for that. And I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that, Steve. Okay, well, shall we leave it there, everybody? Thank you very much for attending. Thank you very much again, Steve.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you very much.
Very good.